Good evening, everyone. It's been a wonderful opportunity to meet all the senior faculty fraternity members of the IMA Porapakampa. Thank you for the evening. So, it's going to be a short talk on the recent advances in the management of brain tumors, especially with regards to the radiation and to the chemotherapy. The main modality of the treatment in brain tumors is mainly the surgical part. I'm not a neurosurgeon, I'm a radiation and a medical oncologist who's right now working in my hospital. So let me go quickly through the basics and elaborately on to the radiation part and the chemotherapy part. Next slide. So brief introduction. So worldwide we do have nearly about 2.3 new cases of brain tumors, and of that nearly more than about 70 to 80% die because of brain-related cause. So we have the NCI database 2015, which has been periodically updated by the National Cancer Institute, USA. And as of now, other than surgery, we did not have any great achievement or advancement in the brain tumors. But there have been the guidelines, as there have been recommendation which was continuously coming out of the various oncology institutions and the organizations across the world. We do have the NCCN group of organization which is working in US. It's a collaboration of about 21 major cancer centers in US which periodically update the brain tumor management. And there's an European group also, European Society of Neuro-Oncology. And in India, we do have the Neuro-Oncology Society, which is run by the Tata Memorial Hospital, Mumbai, and there are various other collaborative networks across India. So, go back. So, which modality is the gold standard modality for detecting a brain tumor? We have symptoms of headache, we have symptoms of vomiting, intractable vomiting, even after so many medications of first generation, second generation, or third generation anti-emetics, patient will not stop vomiting. There will be additional signs and symptoms of intracranial tension, which all lead to the suspicion of an intracranial pathology. And what is the best modality to detect an intracranial pathology would be to go in for an MRI upfront. MRI upfront would let us know whether the disease is active, what is the extent of the disease, and will unnecessarily will cut down the cost of repeated examination. Any neurosurgeon prior to taking up a patient for an advanced surgical procedure would definitely need to have the extent of the tumor, extension into the corpus callosum, extension into the other areas, mainly into the non-resectable areas before they open the cranium. So MRI would be the basic standard, gold standard modality to assess a brain tumor. Gross total resection. We do have another term, maximal safe resection, wherein the patient has to be subjected to the maximum removal of tumor without a neurological compromise. That is the basic principle of having a neurosurgical procedure in oncology. And most often, it's about 60 to 70% will be maximal safe resection. And even then, we do have the residual tissue left behind in the patient's brain. So that it needs to be treated by adjuvant modality. So we do have the data on the survival based on the resection. There is a gross difference in the survival. Even if there is a 98%, less than 98 or more than 98% resection of the brain tumor, we do have a difference of nearly about 4 months median overall survival in surgical part. So we do have the whole histological classification of brain tumors. I'm not going through the each and every histology, but we have moved well beyond the histological classification of tumors. We now know what type of tumor it is, and based on knowing what type of tumor, we subject the patient to more often genomic analysis. For example, the glioblastoma multiforme, which is an aggressive tumor variant. We do not just straight away treat the patient of the glioblastoma multiforme. We do an analysis called MGMT methylation analysis, wherein we check that whether the tumor would be really be susceptible to chemotherapy or not. The check the MGMT gene, which is the methyl guanine, methyl transferase gene, and if it is present, this patient is going to definitely respond to chemotherapy. If the enzyme is not present, we upfront will tell the patient that the prognosis is poor and the expected outcome might not be good. Excellent. So, indications of radiation in brain tumors would be all high-grade gliomas, residual disease, recurrent diseases in low-grade gliomas, and well, benign tumors like pituitary adenoma, craniopharyngiomas, benign meningiomas, where there is a higher residual disease, we do treat them with radiation therapy. The only modality where we do not use radiation is low-grade when the surgical resection is complete. Example of grade 1 and grade 2 brain tumors. So these are the list of grade 3 and grade 4 brain tumors wherein we treat with surgery, adjuvant radiation and adjuvant chemotherapy. And these are the list of benign brain tumors wherein we treat the patients with adjuvant radiation therapy. So what exactly we do in the radiation therapy? Once the surgery is over, we do have the patients assessed by a post-operative MRI to assess how much has the surgeon left behind to maintain the functional status of the patient. But even those limited disease which is left behind in the brain can grow and it can produce recurrent diseases. So what we generally do is we do an MRI post-operatively before starting with radiation to know the exact residual disease. Then we do have something called as a planning CT. Set the patient based on the frame, based on the modality, wherein we have a frame-based system and a frameless system, wherein we put in a mass and we have the coordinates into the patient's cranium or into the skull. It's a small pellet which is either implanted or it is tattooed and then it is implanted onto the CT, planning CT scan. And we do the fusion of the preoperative CT or an MRI, whatever we have, with the postoperative MRI and the planning CT. We fuse all three radiological images onto the planning system and then we derive something called as a fused image, wherein we have the preoperative volume, the PET CT volume, and the postoperative image, wherein we can find out where exactly the tumor was initially, how much was resected and how much needs to be irradiated in the treatment plan. Next. And the radiation oncologist sits with the medical physicist to plan the radiation portals, the dose, risk organs in the brain, and we decide the treatment portals based on the final portal image. This is a small example of what exactly is being done in the radiation department in the treatment of brain tumors. It's a 3 to 4 minutes video.
Causes the cell to grow and divide uncontrollably into more damaged cells. adopt decision correctly during the IMRT.
This is the first step. This is the mask that what we make, and the tablet that what we make during the radiation treatment. And this tablet can be a permanent, based on which we plan the protocols.
Your doctor will use the scans to specify the three-dimensional shape of your tumor and vital tissues nearby.
This is the fusion of the planning CT with the pre-operative and the post-operative MRI.
Help your doctor determine how the IMRT beam should be adjusted to hit your tumor and avoid healthy tissue. During your procedure, a medical linear accelerator will deliver an X-ray beam to your tumor.
You can focus where the tumor is, and we can direct the beams only to the region where the tumor is. This is the collimator, which is determining the size of the tumor in various dimensions when it rotates throughout the x-axis and the y-axis with the z-axis orientation. Usually we have the radiation treatment for about 5 to 6 weeks. And those 5 to 6 weeks, the tumor slowly shrink and they completely regress in susceptible tumors. So what exactly what we have in our hospital is the TrueBeam STX, wherein we have the modality of doing IMRT, stereotactic radio surgery, and stereotactic radiotherapy. These are the advanced form of the treatment. These are the advanced form of radiation, wherein we can deliver the radiation in a fractionated manner, but also in a way where the radiation can be pinpointed to the areas of high-risk regions. For example, in optic chiasma, we cannot go in for a 6 weeks radiation protocol. Instead, we'll have to finish it in shorter radiation protocols with a high dose. For example, optic chiasma or the glial tumors. What we do is we set up the patient in the treatment couch, and then we try to manipulate the collimator movement based on the tumor stage, size, shape, and the orientation and the position, and we try to deliver the radiation. So this is the orientation of how much of the radiation dose is delivered to a tumor based on the opening of the collimator, and we can achieve a dose distribution to completely deliver the dose to the tumor and to preserve the preserve the normal surface. This is an example of a video of a throat cancer wherein we completely save the spinal cord, whereas we completely eradicate the lymph nodes, the primary tumor in the larynx, and the whole region of the neck is receiving radiation except the spinal cord. Directly can prevent any long-term radiation effects to the normal structures. So this is the advantage of the TrueBeam STX machine which we have in Mayor Hospital, wherein we have 120 multi-leaf collimators, each measuring about 2.5 millimeters. All these deliver the precise radiation to the site of tumor based on the position of the tumor. So we can confirm to the tumor shape from any angles. We have a 360 degree liberty of deciding our treatment protocol. We can shape at any angle. We do have the static field and the dynamic field, and we do have the penumbra. Penumbra is the term denoted to a place where we can stop the radiation from going to a normal tissue. So it's like I irradiated the middle of my nose without any dose going to the eyes. Because delivery to the cornea, even a single fraction of 2 gray, will produce corneal opacification. So I can deliver my radiation to the middle of the nose without a single dose going up to my orbital of the eye structures. This is the advantage of the TrueBeam STX machine. This is an example of the radio surgery that we did in our department. This was an international patient from Seychelles, wherein we had an arterial venous malformation. So this is the outcome of the arterial venous malformation after delivering the radio surgery. The tumor can be completely dissolved based on a high-dose stereotactic radiation delivery. Coming to the chemotherapy part, we don't have a great amount of chemotherapy drugs in the past. It was all the older regimens with prolonged toxicity. No major advantage was there. Patients post-surgery with a neurological deficit with chemo-induced toxicity were really suffering. But then for the past 10 to 12 years, we had a drug called temozolomide, which is an oral form of chemotherapy which can be delivered to the patient sitting at home. They don't have to come to the hospital. It's all cheap, it's quite comfortable, and only effective medicine till now. Right now, we do, but for the past 12 years, we didn't have any new medicines. Now, there are a lot of clinical trials which have been happening in the field of neuro-oncology, wherein we have so many medical and non-medical methods. We do have major drugs, but the problem of brain, blood-brain barrier hinders the delivery of the medicines into the brain. So the FDA had approved this tumor-treating field technique, which is right now gaining so much of popularity in the United States and probably across Europe also and various other developed countries. And this is one of the recent advances of treatment in neuro-oncology. Yes, sir. So, yes, sir. So this is a biomedical device which is placed onto the surface of the brain scalp, which delivers the electromagnetic field which prevents tumor growing into the brain tissue. So this is a short video of tumor treating field technique, and I can show you the in vitro explanation of how this TTF works.
TT fields are generated by a pair of transducer arrays placed directly on the skin surface. TT fields disrupt cell division through physical interactions with T molecules during mitosis. There are two well-established physical processes that TT fields use to disrupt dividing cells. Dipole alignment. Dipoles are molecules in which the electric charge is separated. In a uniform alternating electric field, dipoles oscillate in sync with the field. At high frequencies, motion diminishes as the dipoles align with the field. Dielectrophoresis. When electric fields are non-uniform, polarizable objects migrate toward regions of high field density in a process known as dielectrophoresis. Let's now explore these physical processes in biological context. During the metaphase stage,
this is an example of a multiplying field.
As the mitotic spindle forms, the spindle fibers, microtubules, are created through the polymerization of tubulin dimers, which exhibit large dipole moments.
The microtubules pull the cellular armature to the each side of the daughter cell,
and dipole molecules are
subject to the forces.
This contraction is how it occurs to align with the field, inhibiting microtubule formation, leading to metaphase arrest, prolonged mitosis, and cell death. Deformed spindle fibers resulting from TT fields can also lead to abnormal DNA segregation between daughter cells, and eventually, cell death. In cells that manage to complete metaphase and enter cytokinesis, the hourglass shape that forms leads to a non-uniform electric field within the cell. This results in dielectrophoresis, net forces on polarizable objects toward regions of high field density, concentrating macromolecules and organelles toward the mitotic furrow, leading to structural destruction and cell fragmentation. The extent of electrical non-uniformity in dividing cells is dependent on the frequency of the TT fields, the electric properties of the cell, and the orientation of the dividing cell relative to the field. Because cells divide in all directions, TT fields are delivered through two
pairs. This is the advantage of using the TT field in brain tumor, because only the proliferating mitotically active cells are affected by the treating fields, whereas the normal brain tissue is not affected by the treating fields. So these are the results of giving the treatment with the standard surgery, the postoperative radiation, and the drug temozolomide, which is combined with the TTF technique of treatment. Okay.
Okay.
So this is an example of the multiplication of a cancer cell, where we do have the TT-free template, which reduces the mitosis, whereas in the control, we don't apply TT-free, and there is rapid proliferation of the cancer cell. Nearly about 5 months in the overall survival, which is an average advancement in the survival. So this is the latest arm of medical miracle in the field of neuro-oncology, wherein we have something called as immunotherapy, which activates the body's own immune cells to act against cancer. We don't have to give any treatment. This form of therapy is completely without any major side effect, because it's all the body's own immune cells which act against the tumor. We do have a small
Any questions, good evening. I'm Dr. Vijay Sankaran, I'm a surgeon at SIMS Hospital. It was a fantastic presentation. A few basic doubts. You were having a rapid audit, right? You were having a rapid audit.
It's improving, sir.
Proving. And in what way is it better than the other modalities? What are the sub-radiations?
Yes, Proving is the next evolution model of rapid arc. Rapid arc, we do have a limited number of collimators which surround the patient in an arc fashion to deliver treatment. In rapid arc, we do have something called as a flattening filter. What this flattening filter does is it concentrates the dose and increases the number of monitor units delivered in a particular second. So even with rapid arc, when the treatment is about 2 minutes, with this TrueBeam XCX, we do have less than a minute of delivery time. So the actual treatment is less than a minute in this TrueBeam machine. So it's all the technical modifications of the collimators.
So it's a lot better than the old.
The whole thing is somebody is cannot be left alone in a radiation machine for a longer time. So that is the basic modality of the evolution of the radiation technique. We started with an IMRT, it was only a step and shoot. It's like, if I have to deliver radiation to this particular position, the step and shoot technique will be like, the collimator will be positioned here to deliver the direction, then the collimator will have to be moved to another position, then give the radiation. But in rapid arc, what I can do is, I can modify my beam portal so that I can continuously deliver the radiation throughout the arc and throughout 360 degrees to deliver the radiation to that particular spot. So the time taken for the movements, positioning of the collimators, everything is minimized to less than 1 to 2 minutes. Initially it was about 15 to 20 minutes of the treatment. Positioning will take about 5-10 minutes. So it's about 30 minutes for treating one patient. Now the positioning is the same 5 minutes. But the treatment delivery, instead of 15 to 20 minutes, it's less than a minute.
And it's the advantage of TrueBeam over CyberKnife or Gamma Knife for the surrounding brain.
CyberKnife is altogether a different kind of, it's like a robotic surgery.
Yeah, it is very different, but as a referring surgeon, I want to know how much it is better for the surrounding brain, because when the technical advancement happens, the target tumor has been killed with the preservation of the surrounding brain. So I am just...
CyberKnife can be used only for SRS or SRT. We cannot deliver the normal routine radiation in brain tumors with CyberKnife, like AV malformation, and that to size. We can deliver radiation to something like less than 3 centimeters with CyberKnife. Higher the size of the lesion, more the size of the lesion, more of the normal tissue which is going to get irradiated with a high dose. And even a millimeter change in the position, it's going to completely burn the normal structure, number one. Number two, CyberKnife is completely frameless. Patient lies down with a tattoo. There's not going to be any of the markers which is going to be present onto the patient to guide the treatment delivery. Whereas this modality will have the frame-based system wherein there is some complete tracking throughout the treatment. And patient will not move in less than a minute. Whereas for CyberKnife, it nearly takes about 30 to 40 minutes for the delivery to be completely given to the patient, because it's going to be from multiple angles, because the robotic head is going to move all over the room. So there are higher chances of treatment miss. But with this modality of SRS, with the fixed frame, probably we do have this frame-based system. The head is completely fixed. Patient cannot move the head. And more often we sedate the patient before we try SRS or SRT. So that completely removes the patient movement. So that's an additional advantage of protein.
I have a basic comment on the immunotherapy. See, if you take pulmonology and tuberculosis test, so many tests that were popularized by even the central government, polymerase chain reaction, allele recombinase taken from the blood, have all been wiped out and buried now after existing in the community and spending crores of rupees. Finally, now he stands on gene expert. Therefore, your immunotherapy will be successful only when you are able to scientifically prove 3 things. 1, ability of the drug to reach the particular target site which you are aiming at.
Yes, sir.
Second, ability of the drug to not to reach the any other cell. If this ability does not come, again the immunotherapy is going to fail. Have these drugs present in your handling, do they have this ability to reach only the target cell, not to reach the non-target cell?
Definitely, sir. So what we do is, in immunotherapy, we target the tumor antigens. We are not trying to target the normal tissue antigens. Secondly, these tumor antigens are expressed only onto the surface of tumor cells. These immunotherapy antibodies will have that the Y shape wherein we have the variable chains which are specifically made for tumor-related antigens. We do have tumor-associated antigens and tumor-related antigens. They are very specific for only the tumor. And we do have specific drugs for these type of treatment. So it will be more of tumor-directed therapy rather than side effects.
Thank you. Now I request Dr. Subramanian, Class Secretary, to hand over a certificate to Dr. E. Prasad. He's coming up with a long time.